Yes, and Gustav Meyrink and the Golem. And we can have the next slide. And the next slide again. Gustav Meyrink was the illegitimate son of the Austrian actress Marie Meyer and the German nobleman Friedrich Karl Gottlob Freiherr Farnbühler von und zu Hemmingen, whose part in the affair was exposed only after his death. But at that time, Meyrink had no wish whatsoever to have anything to do with the aristocratic family. Together with his mother, the 15-year-old Gustav arrived in Prague in 1883, the same year Kafka was born, and remained in the city for nearly 20 years. He was known as a sportsman and a swordsman and won several rowing competitions. But he was also a dandy, we can have the next picture, with extravagant habits, driving the first car in Prague. You will find him depicted as a demonic and decadent Herr Nikolaus in Paul Lepine's novel Severin's Journey into the Darkness, where you can find him sipping punch from a straw at the cafes. But from early years, he also showed a keen interest in occultism, which of course was in a way startling at a time when tables were dancing from Moscow to Boston. Yet Meyrink's engagement was extraordinary. He joined about every secret society and mystic order available. Rosicrucian, theosophical, spiritual, you name it. These had fanciful names like ancient and primitive rite of masonry, brotherhood of the ancient rites of the Holy Grail in the Grand Orient of Patmos, and old Gnostic church of Eleusis, and so on. He made a startling career in Helena Blavatsky's society and became friends with Annie Besant. He also performed experiments with diets, drugs, and alchemy. But the only constant in his life, apart from practicing yoga, was following what he named the pilot of his life, or the masked figure, a kind of spiritual leader to be found inside rather than outside himself. His nom de guerre in one of the societies was Teravel, which means I go, I seek, I find. The problem, however, was that he seldom found what he was searching for, and sooner or later left in disappointment every society he had joined. Can the next picture? Being both a seeker and a skeptic, he once at a seance snatched a piece of ectoplasm, which the medium had from the medium, and he had it scientifically analyzed as a piece of cheesecloth prepared with chemicals. On the other hand, he never gave up his search for the path leading to other dimensions and to eternal life, to a state of being where you are able to mentally control your body, where you are master of your own destiny, and where you no longer worship gods, but transform yourself into a god. Meyrink's Prague sojourn ended in a debacle. He had founded a bank, but was, on false grounds, accused of fraud and imprisoned. When released, he had lost his reputation and was ruined. But the seemingly hopeless situation resulted in a career as a writer. And in 1904, he left the Golden City. Next. In 1902, we can take another one. yet another one. Thank you. In 1902, he sent a short story to the leading satirical German magazine, Simplicissimus, which was famous, or some would say infamous, for attacking the monarchy, the church, the aristocracy, the petit bourgeois, the police, and the army. It suited mirroring perfectly, since he hated everything symbolized by the spiked helmet. According to one version, Meyring's strange story had been thrown into the waste paper basket when the chief editor, Ludwig Thomas, happened to spike it on his stick. He picked it up, asked what it was, got the answer, something by a weirdo, read it and said, the man might be completely insane, but he is a genius. Meyring kept publishing satires in Simplicissimus. And the anarchist and writer Erich Mühsam later said that he and his fellows around the cafe tables always rejoiced when they found a new Meyring story to discuss for days. Apart from satires, he wrote fantastic stories showing his esoteric interests. The Viennese writer and one-man institution Karl Kraus once summarized the works of Meyring as a combination of Buddhism and a distaste for the infantry. But just as he could mock modern scientific thinking, he could make ridicule of, for example, spiritualism, which he found silly and corny. In the short story, My Torments and Delights in the World Beyond, he sardonically announces that he's communicating his text by spiritualist table rapping. You can also observe Meyring's satirical vein in The Golem when he, as a revenge for his time in prison, depicts the police and the judicial system. German nationalists accused him of being Jewish and a threat to the pure German spirit. The local butcher and baker refused to serve him, and street workers were throwing stones at him. And in 1933, 4 months after his death, his works were among the books burned by the Nazis. Now let's see, with pictures now, a bit lost with the picture, but I think we can take another picture. Yeah, that's fine, and yet another. In 1913 and 14, Der Golem was published as a serial in a magazine, and the book appeared in 1915. It had been a hard work to finish it, bringing a vast material in order, but the result was a bestseller. And when it comes to establishing Prague as, to quote André Breton, the magic capital of Europe, it might well be that the Golem has been of more importance than the works of Kafka. You might say that Meyring did to Prague what Dickens had done to London and Gogol to Petersburg. And although himself a boy, he merged mystical Prague with Jewish Prague. The Hebrew word golem means the unformed, amorphous, and could be used for a being without a soul. Like Adam before, as Gershom Scholem puts it, the breath of God had touched him. Since medieval times, however, it is mostly thought of as a man-made artificial being coming to life by the use of magic in the sense of combining the letters of the Hebrew alphabet in a certain way. Next. Today, the Golem figure is first and foremost associated with Prague and the Talmudic scholar Rabbi Löw. It would probably have surprised the learned man. During his lifetime, he had no reputation whatsoever of being a miracle rabbi. Probably his name was attached to the Golem stories because he lived in the same town as the contemporary Rudolf II, the emperor, well known for his interest in alchemy, astrology, and everything strange and bizarre. In one of the stories, the old stories, the name of Judah Löw ben Bezalel was associated with, but it was only long after his death that the name of Judah Löw was associated with tales of this kind. The first known text dates from 1837. In the early stories, the Golem is a kind of servant, chopping wood and carrying water. although he can go amok if a rabbi forgets to remove letters giving him life. Next. It is said that it was not until the Polish rabbi, Judel Rosenberg, in 1909 published The Golem and the Wondrous Deeds of the Maharal of Prague, that the Golem became a protector of the entire Jewish community and not only a servant of a single rabbi. However, already in 1893, the Polish Yiddish author I.L. Peretz wrote a very short story where the Maharal creates the Golem in order to guard the Prague ghetto. The Golem fulfills his duty in a very decisive way, filling the city with corpses and forcing the Gentiles to plead for peace. It is hardly far-fetched to associate this new orientation with the pogroms in the Russian Empire at the time being, and when it comes to Rosenberg, the so-called Hilsner affair in Bohemia in 1899. In the years to come, the figure was to appear in literary works, movies, and operas. Most important, the expressionist play by Holten Leivik and a film by Paul Wegener. Yes, next. The letter is often referred to as an adaptation for the screen of Meyring's novel, but has nothing to do with it at all. Rather, it was inspired by the stories of Rosenberg. Even Kafka gave Golem a weird try in his diary from 1916, but never finished the story. Later, the Golem has attached the interest of Jorge Luis Borges, Isaac Bashevis Singer, Ilya Wiesel, Cynthia Osik, and others. It is interesting to notice that the more human the creature is depicted, for example, by giving him a name and feelings, as Leivik and Singer do, the more problematic is the eventual destroying of a Golem by the rabbi. Is the rabbi transformed into a murderer? The Golem is also appearing in popular culture, where it can turn into a regular monster. Next picture. And next. We can take next here too. And next again. And well, next. As you might have noticed, the golem in the novel hasn't much to do with a traditional figure of clay. After reading the novel by Meyring, Gershom Scholem stated that the alleged Kabbalah that pervades the book suffers from an overdose of Madame Blavatsky's turbid theosophy, and that the Golem figure in the novel owes very little to the Jewish tradition, even in its corrupt legendary form. Scholem seems merely to notice these circumstances, but some later critics are upset and finds that the novel manifests a disdain for Judaism itself, and that Meyring has made a disrespectful intertextual appropriation of a Jewish legend. But I leave these questions to discuss later if anyone would like to do that. Now some comments on the composition of the novel. When do the events take place, and what is the connection between the frame and the embedded story? The first question is quite easy to answer. Pernath mentions the flood that made the Charles Bridge to collapse in 1890. And when he's released from prison, the pulling down of the ghetto has begun. That is, in 1893. The events in the frame is said to take place 33 years later, that is around 1926, actually 11 years after the book was published. But what about the relation between the man in the frame let us call him X, and Athanasius Pernath in the embedded story. The novel opens with X lying on a bed in a hotel room. He beholds the moonlight shining on the foot of his bed, lying there like a large, bright, flat stone. He is reminded of a Buddhist story of a crow who mistakes a stone for a lump of fat and disappointed fly off like we, the tempters, leave Gautama, that is Buddha, the ascetic, because we have lost our pleasure in him. The stone keeps haunting X, but he cannot figure out what it is trying to tell him. This is the riddle that eventually will be solved in the novel, or will it? According to many critics, X is dreaming the story of Pernath. But that doesn't lead to anything, and it doesn't explain the ending where X is returning the hat to Pernath, living in some kind of other dimensions. By the way, the name Athanasius Pernath, means immortal. I think the answer is to be found in the concept of Ibur. Next picture. Okay, we can take yet another. We have some photos here from the Prague ghetto. And yet another. And one more. And one more. here we have a junk dealer in the ghetto. We'll come back to that. And one more. Yeah, yes. The concept of Ibur, yes. As you might remember, Pernath receives the Book of Ibur by a golem-like figure in the novel. In Kabbalistic tradition, the concept of Ibur is distinct from the concept of Gilgul. The latter means transmigration or reincarnation, while the former, Ibur, is a kind of soul impregnation. There can be two different reasons for this impregnation. In the first case, the soul of a dead person impregnates the soul of a living person for his own needs. In the second case, it is done for the sake of a living person, to aid him, to give him merit, and to guide him. I would say that this is the case in the Golem. X, the figure X, re-experience the life of Pernath in order to learn something. And of course, we, the readers, are supposed to learn the same things. Namely, that you have to reject the material world and be prepared to die in order to live. The story of Pernath is a kind of esoteric Bildungsroman. In the work Access to Western Esotericism, Antoine Fevre makes a distinction between esotericism, which is a worldview, and occultism, which is a way to manipulate the world by some sort of magic. I find Fevre's characterization of esotericism clarifying when it comes to the worldview exposed in the Golem. According to an esoteric understanding of the world, next picture, and next again. Oh, we can go on with yet another picture. And one more. Okay, I can read a bit more. I'm a bit lost now with the pictures, but okay. Yes, it's an esoteric understanding of the world. And this means that there are symbolic and real correspondences that are said to exist among all parts of the universe, both seen and unseen. And they are intended to be read and deciphered. This means that the entire universe is a huge theater of mirrors, and that everything is a sign, and that every object hides a secret. Nature must be read as a book and is essentially alive in all its parts. The accent is placed on vision and certainty rather than belief and faith. And the experience of transmutation, a term borrowed from alchemy, is essential. It is a question of a total metamorphosis, a modification of a subject in its very nature. Well, Meyrink is a syncretist, mixing different myths and religions in the tradition of a Sophia Perennis, or an ancient wisdom to be found at the bottom of all religions and beliefs. But you can also say that it deals with the different traditions as motives making up the theme of a novel. Well, to round, we can take the next picture. Oh, okay, here was fair. That was the one that I read before. So next picture, please. Yes. To round off, let me just point out some motives that might have puzzled you and could be worth discussing later. I'm thinking of the Egyptian god Osiris, the hermaphrodite, the tarot cards, the double, dolls and puppets, death and resurrection, the stone and the lump of fat. And Pernath's relations to the three women, Rosina, Angelina, and Miriam. And his use of uncanny effects and of metaphors are also worth mentioning. The metaphors are dissolving the borders between human and beast, between the living and the dead. Here are some brief remarks. Osiris was the Egyptian god of death and resurrection and has in later traditions been associated with hermetic knowledge and even with the tarot cards. Miriam, the daughter of the,
No, you're right, Miriam.
Yeah, it's okay. Well, she establishes the connection between Osiris and the hermaphrodite when saying that it is one of the goals of life for two beings to fuse into one. Have you ever heard of Egyptian cult Osiris? Something of which the hermaphrodite is a symbol. She continues, but by that I mean the magic union of the male and female principles in the human race to create a demigod as a final goal. No, not as a final goal, as the beginning of a new course, which will be eternal, which will have no final end. And the next picture. And we can have next also. And here we have a hermaphrodite. The next. Meyrink shares the esoteric opinion that the tarot cards can be seen as part of a Kabbalistic tradition. The juggler is the first card in the pack, representing, here is called the magician also, representing the Hebrew character Aleph, which is formed after the shape of a man, with one hand pointing up at the sky and the other downwards, saying, as it is above, so it is below. The juggler has also been said to remind us of the hermaphrodite, the integration of good and evil, above and below. He signifies the absolute container of all possibilities. And the next. Traditionally, the hanged man indicates an interruption in the flow of action and connotates sacrifice of ego and the breakdown of obsolete structures. And these two cards, if you remember, Pernath will find in the room of a golem and is confronted with these two cards and is wondering what they mean, what is the meaning of these cards for him. But maybe we can come back to this if you want to discuss this later. Well, and I will end up with next picture. Vivo, I live, reads the inscription on Meyring's tombstone. It might look paradoxical, but ought to be understood as his sincere conviction. He died on the 4th of December in 1932. His wife, Mina, had promised not to give him any analgesic. In lotus position, his eyes looking into the sun, he wanted to, fully conscious, experience the transition into another state of the mind. Well, that's a bit of an introduction. And I could just mention that The Golem is the first novel by Meyring, and when he wrote four more novels, all dealing with, you might call, mystical things, different character. But all his life, I mean, he was obsessed by these things, trying to find the total wisdom of life in a way.